أفلا يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Welcome to the program, and inshallah ta'ala this program will continue with the characteristics of the muttaqin, those who are believers, those who have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with. Who are these people and what are their characteristics? Something that is mentioned in the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah. And last time we talked about three of five or six characteristics. Three characteristics we talked about: that they believe in the ghaib, they believe in the unseen, they establish the salah, and from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had provided for them, they spend, they give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they believe that the provisions are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the verse number 4 and 5, verse number 4 it says, وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبِلِكَ وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ, which means, and they are the ones, those who believe in what has been sent down unto you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they believe in what has been sent down before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in the hereafter they believe in it with certainty. So these are two more characteristics mentioned in this verse with regarding to those who are al-muttaqeen. And as we mentioned before, our duty when we ponder over the verses of the Qur'an and the purpose of this program is that we ponder over the meanings of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, so that we would act according to the Qur'an. And this is the test and this is the duty of a Muslim, to hold fast to the Book of Allah by reciting, by pondering over its verses, and by acting according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us in the Qur'an. So the belief comes again in the characteristics of those who are al-muttaqeen. وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ, they believe in what has been revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What has been revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that is mandatory for us to believe in? We believe in what has been revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. That the believers, they believe in the Quran. They believe that the Quran is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke the Quran. It's the miraculous wordings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believe in it. And again, as we mentioned before, belief is not just something in the heart, but something that the tongue has to speak about it, and the different parts of our body has to make sure that it's acting according to this belief. So when we believe in what has been revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with regarding to the Quran, that means we are taking care of the Quran, reciting it, pondering over it, and acting according to the Quran, submitting ourselves to what's in the Qur'an, and believing that also the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, something also that has been revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through Jibril alayhi salam, the angel that is responsible for matters of revelation. But the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is in the speech of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam, explains the Qur'an, brings what is permissible, what is not permissible. So they both go hand in hand when it comes to revelation from Allah. Both are revelation from Allah, and we mentioned that before. So the third or the fourth characteristic mentioned with regarding to those who have taqwa, that they believe in what has been revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the Quran, and as a result they would submit themselves to the Quran in full. وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ, and what has been revealed or sent down before you, meaning before the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The believers, they believe since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the messengers of Allah and sent with them books, that they believe in all the books that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the messengers. And they believe in all that has been revealed to the messengers when they were sent to call the people to La ilaha illallah, to worship none but the creator of the heavens and the earth alone. So the believers, they believe in the Suhuf, the Musa wa Ibrahim, that the Suhuf of Prophet Musa and Prophet Ibrahim. They believe in Az-Zabur that was revealed to Prophet Dawood, Prophet David alayhi salam. And they believe in the Torah that was revealed to Prophet Musa alayhi salam. And they believe in Al-Injil that was revealed to Prophet Isa, Jesus alayhi salam. And they believe in the final revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the Quran that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And inshallah ta'ala, if Allah give us life, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, the details of the major books that was revealed to the messengers of Allah is mentioned. And in there it would say that the Quran, the final revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that came and abrogated all the message before, all the revelation before. That means those who believed in the Az-Zabur or the Torah or the Injil, all those who believe in what has been revealed before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's mandatory for them to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to believe in the Quran. If they believe in the books before the Quran, then they have to believe in the Quran. If they don't believe in the Quran, that it was revealed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that means they disbelieve in all that has been revealed to the messengers before, because it's one message and it's one God subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as a result of that, the believers, they believe in everything that has been revealed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the messengers of Allah. But again, when it comes to the Quran in it, all that has been revealed before when it comes to the meanings, and adds to it what the human beings are in need of till the day of judgment. It comes with the comprehensive message to all the needs and the things that people would ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to obey, and the things that are sinful and for them to stay away from. Everything that is needed, the believers would find it in the Quran, explained by the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So the believers, those who are al-muttaqeen, they believe in what has been revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and what has revealed before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُقِنُونَ, and in the hereafter they believe. But the word يُقِنُون, the verb of اليقين, which means they believe with certainty. So this is not just belief, but they believe in it with certainty. Belief, yes, is with certainty, but اليقين is something that a person would have with certainty, very strong belief in the hereafter. And you would see that the word Al-Akhirah comes before the belief in certainty. And this is something in the Arabic language, that you would have something before something else to show the importance of believing in the hereafter. So it didn't say that they believe in certainty in the hereafter. The way the sentence is formed, it says in the hereafter, they believe in it with certainty. So it shows the importance of the hereafter, that without the certainty in the belief in the hereafter, then definitely there is no iman, there is no faith without this pillar of al-iman. And at the same time, the certainty would make the believers as if they are witnessing the hereafter constantly. Because once a person is in state of forgetfulness when it comes to the hereafter, it's very easy to slip away. It's very easy to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the shayateen, the devils, are working day and night. And our own selves, that would tend to make the person more into the lazy state. That and all these different means and the environment around the person and the disbelievers and so on and so forth might make the person fall into the matters of disbelief and matters of kufr and so on. So that's why the believers, they need to have the constant reminder of the hereafter, as if they are witnessing the hereafter, because it's something that definitely has to happen. And when the person's heart is attached to the hereafter, then life on the face of earth becomes easy. And we talked about that before, that how the hearts of the believers when they are in certainty, when it comes to the hereafter, as if they are seeing it. And once they, as if they lifted their head and they can see the hereafter at the end of their path and their journey. And when they see it, and when the hearts are attached to it, that it makes the path easy. The path on this earth that is full of so many different hardship and calamities and temptations and desires and things of that nature, that the Jannah, as the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, حُجِبَتْ الْجَنَّةُ بِالْمَكَارِهِ, that there is a hijab, there is a concealing, there is covering, that a person would not be able to see the Jannah. And this covering is basically the dislikes, as the Prophet ﷺ said. So as if the believers, they see the Jannah, but they see it with their hearts, so that the path to Jannah is made easy for them. And this ease of the path to Jannah is by this certainty. That's why the believers, without the certainty in the hereafter, their life is miserable. So they have to be uncertain, with certainty they believe in the hereafter. Anything that they say, anything that they do, whatever state that they are in, they're constantly remembering the hereafter. Why? Because this is what we work for. This is what we seek the rewards in, meaning in the hereafter. Anything and anything in our life, and this is something that we need to constantly remind ourselves, that anything that we do, if it's not done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking the rewards in the hereafter, it becomes a mean of sorrow and regret. Even the permissible things that everybody does, everybody eats, everybody goes to work, things of that nature, for the believers, they do that with the great intentions. With the intentions that they do this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that they're able to fulfill the purpose of their life, and that is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and to seek the provisions from Allah, to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to rejoice in this life by being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the certainty in the hereafter is definitely something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us, that those who are al-muttaqeen, those who have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their certainty in the hereafter will keep them steadfast and keep their faith high and in a higher level as long as they are in certainty and constantly remembering the hereafter. So this verse, the verse number 4 in Surah Al-Baqarah, we learn from it that the believers, they believe, those who have taqwa, they believe in everything that has been revealed, sent down from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether it's unto the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Qur'an and the Sunnah, or the things that was revealed before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the books that was revealed before the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. It also, we learned that things, or these revelations from Allah, was revealed from the Most High subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has the evidence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Most High, things revealed from up to down. And that's why it's something that we see that these are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, we benefit from it that the hereafter, although it's part of the unseen, the ghaib that we heard before in verse number 3, but this is something that is specific when it comes to the belief in the ghaib. الَّذِينَ أُؤْمِنُوا بِالْغَيْبِ, it's something in general. But the ghaib, one of the specific things in al-ghaib or the unseen, is al-akhira, is the hereafter, the one that comes after this life. They believe in the Day of Judgment, and they believe in it with certainty, with yaqeen. And with this yaqeen and with this certainty, then the matter of the religion will be easy for the believers, and they will be steadfast according to the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, reviewing again, that the believers, they believe in the ghaib, in the unseen, they establish the salah, and they spend from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had provided for them, and they believe in what has been revealed to them, meaning the books, and the books that has revealed before, and in the book, which is the Qur'an that was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they believe in the hereafter. This is how many of the pillars of Islam is mentioned here. When we say وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ, that brings all the pillars of al-Iman. And when we say وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ, that comes the belief in the books. And وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُقِرُونَ, they believe in the hereafter, to show the importance of that the need of the human beings for the books and the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something that they need more than the sun and the moon and the air that they breathe, because this is their everlasting life if they would follow the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the hearts to be attached to the hereafter. Inshallah, the next segment we'll talk about the sixth characteristic, if it's correct to make it a sixth one, when it comes to those who have taqwa to the believers, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make them among the successful ones. And that is inshallah right after the break.
So this is an open invitation for everybody to recognize God and enjoy His blessings in this life and His mercy in this life and in the hereafter as well. Allah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. Each name has a meaning. Each name signifies a nature of Allah the Almighty which no one shares or is compared to Allah in it.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah. Welcome back. And we're still with the characteristics of al-muttaqeen, those who have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the beginning verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. And in the last segment, we talked about what's mentioned in the verse number 4, that the muttaqeen, they believe in what has been revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that is the Qur'an. And they believe in what has been revealed before the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, the books that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to the messengers before. وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ, and they believe with certainty in the hereafter. And we talked about the benefit of that and how this is something that is essential in the life of the believers, essential that they need to remember it at all times. And once at any time that they are in state of forgetfulness when it comes to the hereafter, that means it's easy for them to fall and to slip away when it comes to sins and things of that nature. So it's something that we need to constantly remind ourselves with matters of the hereafter. And one of the means to do that is to recite the Qur'an, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then in verse number 5, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praising those who have taqwa by two things. That they have guidance from their Rabb, from their Lord. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَىٰ هُدًى مِّن رَبِّهِمْ, that they have guidance from their Rabb, from their Lord, their owner, the creator, the provider, the sustainer. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ, and they are the successful ones. And this can be also mentioned as one of the characteristics, or number 6, when it comes to the characteristics of those who have taqwa, that they are guided, and their guidance is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we heard before, that guidance is two kinds. Guidance to all mankind, and the second type of guidance, guidance to the believers. The guidance to all mankind, that is the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, showing the human beings what is good and what is evil for them to accept it. But the acceptance, it's something that is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone for the believers. So the believers, they are on guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it shows that guidance is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by following the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how this can be a characteristic of the believers or those who have taqwa, it shows that they are on the straight path. They have the proper methodology. They are guided, meaning they have the guidance, they are steadfast. They would not misunderstand the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have clear evidences and proofs. Why? Because everything is from their Lord, from their Rabb. So we learn from this that al-muttaqeen is not just the one that would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do a lot of acts of worship, and he is pious and righteous in that sense only. That has to be tied to the knowledge, to the proper knowledge, to the proper methodology, to the proper guidance. That they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on the text, based on the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Qur'an and the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam. And this subject, something that we always have to remind ourselves, that guidance and to be steadfast, it's something that we are followers. We do not invent into matters of the religion. Otherwise, when people do not realize that, they can easily fall into matters of innovation in matters of the religion. And this is definitely a form of deviation that can take the person away from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and subject the person to the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the guidance is to follow the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and that's why when Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, he said, كُلُّ عِبَادَةٍ لَمْ تَفْعَلَهَا الصَّحَابَةَ فَلَا تَفْعَلُوهَا, which means every ibadah, any ibadah, any acts of worship that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum didn't do, do not do. This is how we are followers of the best nation ever brought to mankind, because they understood the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they followed the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was pleased with them. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he died when he was pleased with them. So the muttaqeen, one of the characteristics of the muttaqeen, that they have the correct methodology, the correct understanding, they are guided from the Rabb, the guidance is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Another benefit from this is that those who are callers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who are calling others to hold fast to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they need to be guided, they need to be steadfast and on the straight path, not following their own desires, but following the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even if it doesn't make sense to the people around them, because guidance is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so they will be content. They are nothing but messengers. They are nothing but people that would convey the message to others without trying to compromise the message, without compromising the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that they would please others. And a lot of people, they would fall into this trap. They would compromise matters of the religion so that others would accept it. We would try to make the religion of Islam look like the way of life of others. If people are living a certain way of life, we try to make the religion of Islam look like their way of life so that they would accept it. This is not the proper methodology of calling others to the truth. We need to call them to the truth that has been protected, the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. We do that in the most humble way, in the most kind way, but without distorting the message, without changing it, but being steadfast on the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, the way it was applied and understood among the early generations of Islam. And this is one of the fitan, one of the trials and the tribulations that the Muslims are going through today, in which as a result of certain means of weaknesses that is present, people would tend to compromise matters of the religion, thinking that they are serving the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we would make matters of the religion look fear-seeming to the disbelievers, for example. This is not the job of a Muslim. This is not the job of the caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The job of the caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to convey the message the way it is, but in the most decent way, in the most humble way, in a kind way. But acceptance or rejection, something that is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whoever is guided, this is a gift, this is a bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those who are guided. If they reject the faith, then the punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unto them or their loss is their loss. Why? Because they rejected the faith after it's been explained to them in the most perfect way. Also for the believers, for the Muslims, they need to have this understanding so that the goal is not to prosperous in this life necessarily, although this is something that comes to the believers. But the goal for the believers is the hereafter, is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they understand that this life is full of matters of tribulations and difficult times and things of that nature, and that's why the believers, they need to be steadfast, steadfast on matters of guidance. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَىٰ هُدًى, and عَلَىٰ is one of the words in Arabic language that gives the meaning of al-isti'la, that they are on guidance. That means that they are honored by being on guidance. They have the dignity and the honor of being guided to the religion of Islam, and that this guidance is from their Rabb, from the one that provides for them, from the one that created them. So why they should have the fear or the compromisation of such a beautiful way of life, the perfect way of life? Why should they compromise it then? For what? For the sake of the human beings? This is definitely a deficiency in the certainty, deficiency in the iman that the believers should stay away from. Otherwise, this is one of the characteristics of the hypocrites. So the believers are on guidance. That means they are steadfast on the proper methodology of understanding the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and on guidance from the Rabb, from the creator of the heavens and the earth. وَأُولَئِكَ. The word أولئك is repeated here again to show that these people are honored, meaning the believers, those who have taqwa are honored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to them again, وَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. That they are definitely, they are the successful ones. And هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ meaning the successful. They are the successful ones. And anyone that doesn't have this level, then he won't be among those who have the ultimate success. Al-Falah, which is the pronoun of Al-Muflihun, this characteristic is such a goodness that stays forever. So when we hear in the Adhan, Hayya ala al-Falah, which means come to the success meaning the goodness that you would receive in this life, and it's connected to the hereafter, that means there's no loss in it whatsoever. And al-falah, it means that it would bring all that is good, and it makes the person stay away from all that is evil. All of this comprehensive goodness comes to the believers, to those who have taqwa, as a result of the characteristics that they endured patience in fulfilling it and establishing it in their life. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَىٰ هُدًى مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. That the taqwa, those who have the taqwa and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are the guided ones from the Lord. And again, if we ponder over this, we would see that the word hudan has been repeated again. It was mentioned in the beginning of the surah, the second verse, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. That in the Qur'an, there is guidance to those who have taqwa. And then in the verse number 5, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the believers, about those who have taqwa, that they are guided from their Lord. So the Qur'an has guidance, guidance to all mankind, for them to embrace the deen of Allah, to submit themselves to the deen of Al-Islam, and has guidance to the believers also to learn and to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them. And if they would endure patience and seek the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, then they will be among those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would guide them. So this is basically, as we heard also in Surah Al-Fatiha, that this is the most important need. See how much it's been repeated. Repeated in Surah Al-Fatiha, in the second verse of Surah Al-Baqarah, and in the fifth verse of Surah Al-Baqarah, the word guidance, huda, that means we as believers, we as Muslims, we need to hold fast to matters of guidance, and we seek guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by following the Qur'an and the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَىٰ هُدًى مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Correcting our own understanding that who are the successful ones? Those who would have these characteristics. Who are the ones that are guided? Those who would establish these characteristics. If people say otherwise, then we do not follow that. We follow the pure revelation, the perfect revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means the guided ones, those who are misguided, is according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. And it's a criteria for us to see where we at. Are we among those who are successful? We have deficiency. Do we have deficiency in one of these characteristics so that we can fix it before it's too late? Because this is the time to fix these deficiencies by repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and by seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and by being patient in fulfilling these characteristics. So again, quick review to what we mentioned when it comes to the characteristics of those who have taqwa, so that we apply it in our life before we move on to the ways of the disbelievers. The characteristics of the believers are that they believe in the unseen. This is number one. They establish the salah. And again, you can say that these are titles to details that we need to start practicing in our life, so that we need to start learning about the unseen so that we believe in it. We need to start learning about how to establish the salah and how to learn the conditions of the salah and the purity and the pillars and the conditions and so on and so forth, so that we protect our salah and perfect it. The obligatory salah and the optional salah, the night prayer, the duha prayer, and so on and so forth. So they believe in the unseen. They establish the salah, and to ponder over what is the meaning of establishing, yuqimun, taking the salah serious. And number three, that they spend, they give charity, the obligatory charity, which is the zakah, the optional charity, and they do that when they believing that this is something that is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so they humbly give for the sake of Allah. They don't give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while they are in state of arrogance. They do that when they are humbly being happy and rejoicing that they have the opportunity to spend from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had provided for them. And that's why the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to be more happy when someone would come and ask for wealth. They would be more happy than the one that is asking. Why? Because he opened the gate for them for good deeds. Believing in the unseen, establishing the salah, giving the charity, the obligatory one and the optional one. They believe in all the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Qur'an and the books before the Qur'an. They believe in the hereafter with certainty, as if they are witnessing it, so that they are constantly steadfast on the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number six, they are guided. They have the proper methodology, the proper understanding. They are not deviated. And the guidance is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that the only way that a person is to be guided is to follow the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be a follower of what is mentioned in the Quran and in the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. If a person would fulfill this, not just in general terms, but in every speech, in every action, in all of our affairs, then the person will be among the successful ones. Successful one in this life and in the hereafter. Whether the disbelievers see that or that they don't see it, we get the right criteria to differentiate between what is evil and what is truthful by reciting the Qur'an. And the Qur'an already puts our foot in the beginning of the path to get to know the characteristics of the believers, to be among the successful ones in this life and in the hereafter. We continue, inshallah ta'ala, right after the break.
Who should you marry? When is it time for divorce? I want my children to love Islam, but I don't know how. The Quran and Sunnah has the answer to these questions and more. To find out what those answers are, check out Family Issues and see the difference clear guidance makes.
Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah. Welcome back. And before we continue with the tafsir of the verses in Surah Al-Baqarah, I just remind you that as you see the email, that you can send us your suggestions and your comments and your questions with regarding to anything that relates to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the Qur'an, so that we can make the verses of the Qur'an something that is alive in our life, in our speech and our actions, because we need to do that. This is not something that is optional. It's something that is mandatory for us, and we need to understand and take the time to understand the Qur'an and to act according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. And usually the first Monday of every month, this is where we give more time with answering the questions and your suggestions and so on. So please write to us. With the first verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, as it's mentioned before, there are three categories. There is the muttaqin, those who have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the pious, the righteous one. And there is the disbelievers, and there is the hypocrites. And as it's mentioned before, the reason or the wisdom behind having these different groups, which is basically all the human beings, is for the human being to choose for his or her own self, which group that he or her wants to be among. Wants to be among those who have these beautiful characteristics, those who humble themselves to the Creator of the heavens and the earth, and establish the salah, and give charity from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided for them. And they believe in all the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was revealed before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. and they have certainty in the belief in the hereafter, then they are definitely the guided ones. Or the person, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbids, would choose to be among the disbelievers or among the hypocrite ones. And that's why we need to know the evil so that we avoid it. Otherwise, if we do not know the evil, then a person can easily fall into the traps of the evil that is widespread. And that's why the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they work constantly for the deviation of the believers. And that's why the believers, they need to hold fast to the book of Allah and to the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So we saw that in three verses, it sums or gives in general the characteristics of the believers. And then we would see in verse number 6 and 7, only two verses, talks about the disbelievers. And then 13 verses, from verse number 8 all the way to verse number 20, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will explain about the hypocrites. And this is what we need to spend, inshallah ta'ala, if Allah give us life, more time in trying to talk about the hypocrisy and the characteristics of the hypocrites. And the misunderstanding really that many of the Muslims today, they have when it comes to hypocrisy. We limit it to one form of hypocrisy only, when there are more than one type and many characteristics that we need to stay away from. But before we get into the characteristics of hypocrites, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the disbelievers only in two verses. Because disbelief is the opposite of belief. So there's not too much need to expose the characteristics of the disbelievers in this context, because basically they are the ones that denied the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They chose to live their life following their own desires and not to humble themselves and prostrate and worship the creator of the heavens and the earth. So verse number 6 in Surah Al-Baqarah, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. That indeed those who disbelieve, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, كَفَرُوا meaning disbelieved, whether you warn them or you don't warn them, they shall not believe. What does that mean? It means that the disbelievers, and the word kafaru or disbelievers, literally in the Arabic language means that they concealed something. And that's why the tiller or the one that farms the land is called linguistically kafir, meaning that he hides the seeds in the ground. So the seeds are hided in the ground, he hides the seeds. So the word kafir linguistically means the one that hides something. So hiding what? Hiding al-iman. Exposing and showing the disbelief. As if it gives us the feeling that the iman or the belief is something that is in the nature of the human beings. As we know that all human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them witness that He is the Lord of the heavens and the earth, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That it's in the nature of every human being that they know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the provider, the sustainer, the creator of the heavens and the earth. But then they need to worship Him alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and submit themselves only to the creator of the heavens and the earth. And this is the message of Al-Islam. That's why the first obligation to the human being is to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one worthy of worship. That you would find ways of life, they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He is one, but it's not sufficient for them till they believe that He is the only one worthy of worship. He's the only one worthy of them turning to Him alone in matters of prayers, in matters of supplications, dua, in matters of vows and slaughtering and so on and so forth. All forms of obedience to Allah and worship is to only be done for the sake of the Creator of the heavens and the earth alone. So the disbelievers, those who hide the truth and they are denying the belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Creator of the heavens and the earth and they do not worship Him alone, if they die in that state, whether the Prophet ﷺ warned them, or whether he did not warn them, they shall not believe. Meaning those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew that they would die in the state of disbelief. This verse, as the ulama they say, was revealed to comfort the Prophet ﷺ. Because the Prophet ﷺ, as it's mentioned in many verses in the Quran, that he was so eager ﷺ for the guidance of all mankind, that he would weep alayhi salatu wasalam for his ummah, for the people that he was sent to, and the Prophet ﷺ was sent to all mankind. He was eager and having this zeal that everyone would follow the religion of Islam and submit themselves to the truth that the Prophet ﷺ was sent with. But it is the qadr, it is the destiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He created the human beings. Some of them are believers and some of them are disbelievers. And with the opposites and with the struggle between the truthful ones and those who follow the evil, then the truth will show. And this is something that by the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this verse is to comfort the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam that the disbelievers, if they die on the state of disbelief, there is something that the Prophet ﷺ would do for them. The job of the Prophet ﷺ is to convey the message to them. The job of the Prophet ﷺ is to convey the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Guidance and the change in the hearts of the human beings, it's something that is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guidance for them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide them. But because of their own evil doing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may deprive them from guidance as a result of their evil doing, as it will be mentioned inshallah ta'ala. So the disbelievers, whether the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and those who followed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sawa'un alayhim, a'andhartahum meaning from al-indhar, from warning. And this is one of the jobs of the messengers of Allah, that they warn the disbelievers. They won't give the glad tidings and the good news to the disbelievers. They would only give them the good news if they would embrace the religion of Islam. They would tell them that if you submit yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you believe that there is no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you will be among the believers, those who would be among the successful ones in this life and in the hereafter, those who will enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they need to be in the state of submission first. They need to submit themselves to be Muslims for them to be saved from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they would warn them that if they would choose the state of disbelief and they die in that state, then their abode is the hellfire forever as a result of the injustice that they committed against their own selves when they denied the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one worthy of worship. When they believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He is the provider, the sustainer, and so on and so forth, how can they not believe that He is the only one worthy of worship? So as a result of that, they deserve to be punished in the hellfire forever if they die in the state of disbelief. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive matters of shirk. If a person dies on that state, that means the sins would not be forgiven unless a person would repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before the moment of death. So this verse, we should not misunderstand it, because some people, they would say that the infidels or the disbelievers, they are going to stay as disbelievers. Of course not. Everybody is being called to submit themselves, and whoever save his own life by embracing the religion of Islam and submitting oneself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to follow the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, definitely saved himself or herself from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it shows, and it's a benefit from this verse that we learn, that the jobs of the messengers is to warn. And as a result of that, if we want to be among those who are followers of the messengers of Allah, we need to do both. We need to give the glad tidings, as the Prophet ﷺ said, "Bashiru wa la tunaffiru." That means give the good news, give the glad tidings, and do not make people run away from the pure message of Islam. Giving the good news by informing them about the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He created them to have mercy unto them, that if they obey Him and they would fulfill the orders of Allah, which is something that is so easy and simple. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not order us to kill ourselves or to give all of our wealth or to live a life of misery. This is not the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do what is good, to establish the salah, to be truthful, to be staying away from injustice and lying and so on and so forth. This is something that every human being by nature, if we ponder over it, something that we all like. But the person needs to be patient when it comes to the orders of Allah. So As followers of the Messenger of Allah, we need to give the good news and the glad tidings, and also we need to warn. And warning, usually the human being doesn't like warning. But what can we do? If you see someone that is about to fall into the fire, about to kill himself, won't you warn that person and you will be more benefiting to that person than someone that is giving him the good news? Then we will be deceiving people. If we see that people are committing disbelief and associating partners with Allah, that are falling into the hellfire as a result of that, how can we not say anything? How can we not warn them? But we cannot force them. This is not something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade us of forcing anyone to embrace the truth. Although it would have been better for them, but no one can change the hearts except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody can change the hearts of others. You cannot even change your own heart. You cannot even change the heart of the closest one to you. So as a result of that, we seek the help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And our job is to convey the message, is to give the good news and to warn also, and to warn in the best way so that they don't run away. But we need to be honest and sincere to them. If you live among them, you need to tell them and inform them that if they die in the state of disbelief, then they will be among the people of the hellfire, because they need to worship the creator of the heavens and the earth alone. And whether people would like the warning that we would say, whether they don't like, it is our duty to warn by the kind way, by the good words, and by being kind to them and taking all the permissible means. This is definitely a duty and a job that should be done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that people would see the truth, and whether they embrace the truth and follow it or whether they deny the truth, then it's up to them. But as it's clearly mentioned in the Quran, those who would obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the successful ones. And those who would deny the truth and choose disbelief and die in that state, they will be among the disbelievers, those who would stay in the hellfire forever. So the verse number 6, we learn from it that the disbelievers, those who would reject the faith, whether you warn them, whether you don't warn them, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will for their guidance, they will be guided. But we still need to warn, we still need to call others to the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the hearts are content with the qadr, with the destiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That everything is in the hands of Allah. So there is no need for you to compromise your religion when calling others to the deen of Allah. You need to call them to the truth in the best way, in the most humble way, but without compromising the truth, not even the slightest amount of the truth. We need to hold fast to it. And it shows also the honor of al-Iman, that al-Iman or faith is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose from among His creation to be the believers, that the believers should rejoice, that this is the most valuable and the most precious thing that a person can receive on the face of earth, is al-Iman, is guidance, to be guided, to be among the believers. Because we see that it's not based on one's intellect, on one's smartness. You won't find a person, you might find a person that is very smart and reached a very high level in society and so on, but they cannot see the truth. They cannot see the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that would reflect on us that it is the most valuable thing in one's life is to be guided, to be steadfast on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the biggest ni'mah, the biggest bounty. So that the believers, why should they complain because of lack of some materialistic needs? Their life should be different than the lives of the disbelievers. They should appreciate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose them to be among the believers. So as a result of that, the great benefit that we need to take from this verse and from the verses before, that this is a great honor that a believer be among the believers, that we get to recite the Qur'an, that we get to rejoice and to try to apply the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what the real competition should be. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَفِي ذَلِكَ فَلْيَتَنَافَسِ الْمُتَنَافِسُونَ, that in this people should compete with one another. And this is the real competition before it's too late. And the disbelievers, we should not be deceived by their way of life. We should not imitate their way of life. We should look to them as people that need help. They need the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not that we are the ones the need of them. We are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. We are in need of the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And as a result of that, we need to convey this guidance and these means of guidance to the disbelievers because they are in need of help. In the Day of Judgment, when nothing would benefit the person except one's iman and good deeds, then their regret will be too late for them. So if the person wants to be the best to humanity, these are the believers. The Muslims supposed to be the best to all human beings. Why is that? Because they have the truth and they need to convey that truth to save people from the hellfire. And this is something that we have to look in things into the proper way. What is the most human rights that the human beings should have? The basic human rights is that for them to know about the religion of Islam, so that the message of Islam is not distorted when it comes to their understanding. They need to have the message of Islam explained to them in the clear way, without any distortion. And this is the basic human rights that many people on the face of earth are deprived from as a result of the distortion meant by certain people. And that's our job, is to clear the way, is to convey the message in the proper way and to seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Inshallah ta'ala, we continue next time if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us life with certain things mentioned still about the disbelievers and then the characteristics of the hypocrites. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا